good to see everybody this morning. It's a beautiful morning here at the end of a wonderful summer. And I have I'm going to be preaching out of a very familiar passage to us. We've actually been looking in Galatians chapter 6 for a little while now. And this is the same verse that Pastor actually used last week. And it is, the title of my message this morning is, Do Not Grow Weary. And our theme verse here is up here, and it's Galatians 6:9. It says this, So let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we do not give up. Now, I actually got saved, and I kind of grew up using the NIV. And it actually says it a little bit different, and so I'm going to read it in that real quick as well, just so you can get a sense of where I'm coming at it from today. And it says, Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time God will reap a harvest. For at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Don't grow weary. I don't know if you've ever gotten to a situation where you just felt so frustrated. You got to a point where you just wanted to give up. You just wanted to quit. You got so upset with something. You were trying something. You were working at it so hard. You were working at it so diligently. And things just weren't working out. And you got to the point where you were just like, oh, I've just had enough. I've just had enough. There's actually something young people right now. There's a kind of a famous thing. One of the big things for kids now is they love to play video games, right? And they play video games on the internet, and they watch other people play video games, and video games are a big part of young people's culture right now. And one of the things that they have, they actually have a whole term for this when they become so frustrated they just want to quit and they want to give up. It's called rage quitting. Right? And what happens is they're playing a video game and they're trying to do something and they're trying to do something and they can't get past this one particular thing. And they're working at it and they're working at it and they can't get it. And they keep going and they keep going and they have to respawn is what they call it, where you start over again and you go back and you try and do the thing and you just keep going back and forth and back and over trying to do it. And you get so frustrated that you just quit. And some people like throw their, you know, controllers and they do this crazy stuff and it's called rage quitting. It's something that all the young people on the, what's that, Stitcher? What's the thing where you watch all the videos? YouTube. No, the other one. Twitch. It's the thing on Twitch and stuff that they have such a problem with is people rage quitting and doing all that stuff. So. Now, it doesn't always have to be something that gets you so worked up like that. Sometimes it can be the simplest thing. It can be something so simple. And like right now, we're in coming toward the end of the summer. And something that I love, I know we have a lot of Italians in here, but one of my favorite things in the world is just that perfect tomato sandwich. Right? Where you find a tomato, you find one that's really good, it's gotta be fresh, it's gotta be real, you can't be going to the grocery store to get a tomato for a tomato sandwich, right? You have to get this amazing tomato, you slice it all up, toast, mayo, tomato, salt and pepper, that's it. And then walk away, right? And then go get something to drink and then come back and you eat it and it's just perfect, right? Now, some people, they don't like it, but I'm telling you, there is nothing better than a good tomato sandwich. The problem is that it's really, really difficult to find a good tomato. Like, you go, again, you go back to the grocery store, you buy a tomato from it, you're cutting it open, and it's like white inside. You're like, there is no flavor, there is no goodness inside of this tomato, it's just nasty. And so you either have to like begrudgingly eat that as part of your sandwich, or you get to the point where you're just like, you know what, I'm not doing this. This is garbage, these are just red balls of disgusting, and I'm not going to eat these. It doesn't have enough flavor where I'm gonna try and put this into my body and I'm gonna get anything out of it. And so I actually, there's times where I get so frustrated about trying to find a good tomato that I just give up for long periods of time. All throughout, you know, the beginning part of the summer and stuff like that, I usually give up. It's not till the end when the local stuff starts coming out, then you can go to a local place, you can get a tomato, you can make an amazing tomato sandwich. You get frustrated sometimes trying to find perfection. You get frustrated sometimes trying to find something that's going to work. And what can happen is we decide we're just going to give up. That same thing, if we're not careful, that same attitude can creep into our Christian walks as well. Sometimes we can struggle so much at wanting to do everything right for the Lord that we just get sick of trying. God sets a pretty high bar for us in His scriptures. And if we look at it, it can be one of those things where it's almost impossible. We feel like it's almost impossible to get to it. The world record for the high jump. I'm not sure if it's the world record or Olympic record, I forget, but it's 8 feet. Now, 8 feet is roughly the top of that door over there. And so somebody just jumping has to be able to jump over the top edge of the door there without touching the bar, without making the bar come down. There's only been one person who's ever done it. That's why it's the world record. So the average person, they look at it and they say, man, I would never get over that. And the average person probably wouldn't. It would take lots of training and lots of hard work and lots of doing things and building up to it. And then maybe you could be good enough to one day break that record. Somebody probably will at some point. But what happens is along the way, somebody could get frustrated and just give up. So this week we're going to look at not growing weary in doing good. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to ask that you would please be with us as we open up your word this morning. And I pray that you would speak a message to your people today and that you would use me to do it, Lord. Help them to see what you would have them see about your scripture this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So I guess the thing that I would start with is this. There's several things that we can kind of take away and look at here this morning about not growing weary. The first thing is this. Everyone struggles with sin. Everyone struggles with sin. I don't care who it is. I don't care how long you've been a Christian. I don't care how perfect you are at running all the different things and being great and helping out, and you could be the greatest missionary out there on the missions field doing incredible things for God. You're going to struggle with sin. Pride, jealousy, passions, desires, greed, hatred. These are all things that creep up into our lives at different times. It's not like when you become a Christian, when you give your heart to the Lord, that you instantly lose any temptation. It's not that when you give your heart to the Lord, you instantly have no desire to do what's wrong. Sometimes there's things inside of us that still force us or that still bring us along to wanting to do wrong. And it's something that the Lord works in us as we go along. It's something that the Lord moves inside of us, and His Holy Spirit, who we say is welcome here, He'll come in and He'll minister to us and help us to want to stop doing those things. But all of us, it doesn't matter who we are, continue to struggle with them. Pastor just recently finished a series in which he was talking about what we believe as Christians, and not just what we believe, but how we're supposed to behave as a result of that. And he laid out so perfectly what we should be aiming for. He showed us that mark of perfection, that high point of where we're supposed to try to get to. He showed us all the things that as Christians we should want to do, we should desire to do, and we should work toward doing. And we should allow the Lord to do through us. And yet, I can almost guarantee that if you were really listening and really paying attention throughout that series, there was something in there that he was saying, and as Christians, we do this. And you were like, oh, I'm a Christian, and I struggle with that. And we could get to the point of thinking like, man, I'm the only one. I'm that guy who's pretending to be a Christian. I'm that girl who's coming to church on a Sunday, and I come in and I put on a good show, and then when I leave, you know, I'm really struggling with this. And we can start to think that we're the only one who goes through that. I spoke with a young mother recently who talked about some of the difficulties that she was going through. Of just, kids are tough. Kids are tough. When you first have kids especially, I feel bad. They, postpartum and all these things that women have to deal with sometimes. And guys, you know, when you're there too, you're learning how to now handle your wife, which your relationship is completely different, and also your child. Women have the same thing. They're like, I have this baby, I got to take care of it all the time. Now my husband, how do I interact with him? How do I give him any kind of attention, or am I just focused on the baby? There's all kinds of things that start swirling, and it can be so frustrating at first. And it's amazing how somebody can just kind of relax a little bit when they know that they're not the only person who's ever gone through that. You're not the only person who's ever struggled. It's okay. When we had kids, we, I thought I was the only person who has a hard time with that. I was like, no, you're not the only one who's ever felt like taking your child and leaving it on a doorstep and ringing a doorbell and at their grandparents' house and just running away. My parents actually did that to us at one point. We frustrated them so much that they took us over to our grandparents' house. They sat us down. They knocked on the door. They got in the car, waited till the door opened, and then they drove away. You know, sometimes you just need a break. Sometimes you have to realize that you're not the only one. In fact, every person who says that they don't sin or that they don't struggle with sin is not telling the truth. And I know this because in 1 John 1:8 it says this, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Christians struggle with sin. The Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 7, he lays out some of the struggles that he had. He says, oh man, the things I want to do, I don't do. But the things I don't want to do, I feel like I just keep doing them. It happens. Everyone goes through it. You are not alone. If you're still struggling with sin, I say good. I say good, because there are only two kinds of people, those who are struggling with sin and those who have given in to sin. If you're a Christian and you're walking with the Lord, you're going to come up, there's forgiveness for sin, there's God's grace over us in our lives, He forgives us and all those things, but sometimes we start to think like, okay, well that means that I shouldn't have this thought anymore. I shouldn't have this desire anymore. And it's definitely a desire that we shouldn't have, but if it's still there, we have to learn how to deal with that and figure it out. And we got to allow the Lord to work in it. We got to allow the Lord in and the Holy Spirit to come and to help us. It's crazy how there's different things where you can have a desire to serve God and you can have a desire to do what's right. And at the same time, something's just pulling at you so much. There are people out there all the time who pray the prayer, Lord, help me to not do this thing. Help me to not walk into this. Help me to stop struggling with this, Lord. We all struggle with sin. But I'd rather you struggle than just give in. And that's what the Lord is telling us here. Something else that's important for us to know as we're looking at all this, and it can really help you with dealing with this, is that God knew we would sin. God knew we were going to sin. Your struggles with sin are not a surprise to God. He's not sitting up in heaven like, oh my goodness, what are they doing? What's going on here? You're not catching God off guard when you're having a hard time or where you're going through something. All throughout the book of Deuteronomy, all right? I was looking through this again this week, and I always think about this when I'm thinking of people who are struggling with sin and going through things, or if I'm going through it myself a little bit. There's some interesting things in the book of Deuteronomy. A billion
million times throughout the book of Deuteronomy, God lays out there, and either God or Moses or both of them, they say to the people, hey, if you just do this, it's going to go well for you. All right? God gives them the law. Hey, you know, Ten Commandments, all the things. And he says, all right, if you just do this, it's going to be okay. You're going to be all right. Things will go well for you in the land I'm about to put you into, the promised land. If you just do these things, it'll be okay. And they're like, okay. He's like, but if you don't do them, it's not going to go well for you. There's going to be problems. And all throughout the book, but he's constantly encouraging, constantly saying, hey, these are the things. Here's the stuff. This is what you want to try and do. This is what you want to aim for. All right. And then we get to an interesting spot. Do you have that first scripture, verse 4? This is right toward the end of Deuteronomy. And it's just such a great indicator and show of just the struggle that we have. In Deuteronomy 31:12, it says this, assemble the people, men, women, and children, and the foreigners residing in the towns, so that they can listen and learn to fear the Lord your God and to follow carefully all the words of the law. So he says, get everybody together. We're going to read the word of the law again. We're going to read God's word. We're going to look at it. We're going to know exactly what we're supposed to do. And we can go out there and we can make sure that we're doing it. Now, four verses later, this is what God says. Deuteronomy 31:16. He's talking to Moses. And the Lord said to Moses, you are going to rest with your ancestors. He wasn't allowed to go into the promised land. And these people will soon prostitute themselves to the foreign gods of the land they are entering. They will forsake me and break the covenant I have made with them, or they have made with me. Four verses later, he says, gather all the people together. Tell them what they should be doing. Tell them that it'll go well with them. Tell them that they'll be blessed if they do these things. Four verses later, he turns around and he says, all right, Moses, they're not going to do it. They're not going to do it. I gave them this thing. I told them what they need to do right. I sent them out there. I want them to do well. They're going to go, and they're not going to be able to get it done. A whole four verses later, he knew that it was going to happen. Yet he still brought them into the promised land. He didn't turn around and say, you know what, Moses, I could see their hearts. I know you read them this thing. I know that you told them what they're supposed to do, but I could see what's going to happen. You know what? We're going to call this thing off. He still brought them into the promised land. He still led them. They were still his people. He was still working. There were still things that he was doing in the midst of the struggles that he knew that they were going to have. Because the line of the Messiah was going to come through those people. Jesus was going to come through the people of Israel. And he said, they're going to go into my promised land. I'm going to continue to work in them. They're going to fail. They're going to mess up. I'm going to have to, let them know where they're making mistakes. I'm going to have to show them where they're doing wrong. But I'm going to stay with them. It didn't catch God off guard one bit. Jesus knew when he died to set us free that we would continue to fail. And he died anyway. He knew that we were going to struggle, and he did it anyway. And why did he do that? Because he knew that it won't be this way forever. It's not going to be this way forever. There will be a time when your biggest struggles, when the hardest thing, when the thing that you don't talk with people about, that you're like, man, I am so embarrassed that this is still a problem for me. There's going to be a time where you overcome it. There will be a time where you're set free. I don't have a slide for this one, but it's very important. I've done a wedding recently, and I've done a funeral recently, and it was weird. I shared the same scripture verse at both, and because it really fits for two different kind of occasions, and it was in 1 Corinthians 13, and it's the love chapter, and it talks about love is patient, love is kind, and all those things, and it walks you through all the different aspects of love. And a lot of people will talk about how all those descriptions are things, they're descriptions of Jesus. But a little bit below that, it says this. In 1 Corinthians 13, 8 through 13, it says this. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. Here's the important part for us this morning. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child, and I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. For now we see a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we will see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Jesus is the embodiment of love that we read early on in the chapter. Love is coming back one day. Jesus is coming back one day. And while we're not perfect right now, and we never will be this side of heaven, it doesn't matter how long you live, it doesn't matter how good you are, you could lock yourself away in a covenant and do all these different things and just read the scriptures every day, first thing, the last thing. There's going to be sinful thought, there's going to be a sinful something that you're going to struggle with in your life. But Jesus says, it's okay, I have grace for that. I have grace for that. And one day, you will be made perfect. One day you're not going to have that struggle anymore. No more struggles, no more weakness, no more sinfulness. One day we will be able to overcome everything that we fight against. It just might not be yet. Might not be. There's people who are set free from those things all the time. They come, they pray, they seek the Lord, and they get released from it. They get set free from it. The addiction that they're struggling with, the difficulties that they're having. God comes in and he ministers to you right here. That might not be what happens for you in your situation. But one day, you will be made perfect. And you will not have a problem with that anymore. There's help. There's things that God's going to do for you along the way to get us to that point. But it might be in heaven before we get there. But that day of perfection is coming. It is coming. So don't grow weary. Don't grow weary. Don't give in. Continue the fight. Fight the good fight. When you're having that thought, when you're having that temptation, when you're having that desire, when you're having that struggle, give it to the Lord. And then if you mess up and you fall into it again, or you struggle, you find yourself doing something that you're not supposed to do, go right back to the Lord. Don't hide from him. Don't pull an Adam and Eve. Don't go disappear into the garden somewhere and have God have to walk in there and say, hey, where you at? What's going on? Even though he knows already, he already knows. Go to God, say, Lord, I've done it again. And the Lord is there, and he's there to pick you up, and he's there to help get you moving again. Don't grow weary in doing good. Don't give up on doing right just because you feel the pain of failure. Pain can be a good thing. It isn't always. It is not always. But pain can be a good thing. Pain can actually be an indication of growth. My youngest son, he is really tall. Like, he grows so fast. It's crazy. And I remember when he was just little. He was just a little dude. He was growing so fast. Your kids ever have growing pains? Yeah, right? And I got a couple of people put their hands up. His legs would hurt so bad. And he'd be trying to go to sleep. I'm getting some parents with some head nods, like, oh, yeah, I know that. And you'd be putting him down for bed, and he would just be like, my legs hurt so bad. And my wife, the angel that she is, she would go in there, and she would rub his legs and help him to be able to fall asleep. Just enough, you know, it doesn't take but a couple minutes. Just give him enough relief where he'd be able to fall asleep, and then she would come out. But that pain was an indication that he was growing. He was getting taller. The reason he's got pain in his legs is because his legs are stretching out. And you could almost watch him grow. You know, it was crazy how fast he was growing. Pain in your legs when you're a kid is usually an indication that you're growing. And that same is true in our spiritual lives. If you haven't struggled with sin in a while, it might mean that you're not growing. Now, prosperity people, they're not going to tell you that. But I guarantee if you're not struggling with sin, there might be something where you're not feeling that pain of like, oh man, God, I can't believe I've done this again. It might be an indication that you're not growing. Might be. Or maybe you're doing really good. But most of us, we're struggling with stuff and we're working against something. That pain is there. That's a good thing. It's a great reminder to us that we're still moving in the right direction. All of us need to feel that pain from time to time. Don't grow weary in doing good. You're going to be okay. You're going to be okay. Continue moving forward. Feel the pain. Accept the pain. Say, Lord, I know I've done wrong. Now help me to do right. Pick yourself up. First, lay it down at God's feet. Go to him. Say, I'm sorry, Lord. Pick yourself up and keep moving forward in the Lord. Don't give up just because you say, I can't stop doing this. I keep struggling in this way. Keep moving forward. Let God move in you. Don't give up. Don't give up. You don't need to give up for one huge important reason. And it's because God still loves you. God loves you. He's paid for your forgiveness already. I don't know if you realize this, but Jesus already died on the cross. It's not like some future thing we're looking to. Like he was on the cross already. So all the sins that you're going to commit in your life, he took on himself already. He knew they were going to happen. That'll blow your mind, right? Like, wait, this thing that I'm going to do later today because I'm an idiot and I'm going to fall into it. He knew that was going to happen. The punishment for that sin that you're going to commit later today, tomorrow, this week, whatever, was already put on him. He took it. He faced it. It's already been paid for. Walk in your forgiveness. Don't give in to the sin. But walk in the forgiveness. Try and serve the Lord. Move forward. And allow God to come in and do what he needs to do in you. Don't grow weary. Don't let your struggles keep you from God. Because he's the only one who can set you free. If not in this life, then in the next. He loves you and he will forgive you every time you blow it. So don't get down on yourself. I get it. It's painful. It hurts. You want to do better. That's a great thing. You got the right kind of heart about it. He knows the difference between those who are actually trying to just get over on him and say like, oh, yeah, Lord's going to forgive me. All right, I'm going to go out. I'm going to party tonight, right? He knows the difference between the person who's just using God as like, oh, yeah, God's got it, and the person who actually wants to live for him, who actually has them as the Lord of his life and is trying to do right and is failing. There's times where we struggle and there's times where we mess up. And he forgives those who are honestly seeking him. You know what happens sometimes is sometimes we forget how much we're loved. Sometimes we forget how much God loves us. My older son just recently started driving. Oof. But before, you know, you're a parent, right? So you want your kids to you want to protect them, you want to be careful with them. So my son, we had a car for him. We were like, all right, let's get the brakes worked. You know, so we worked on the brakes. We got the brakes all going good. You want to make sure they can stop when they need to stop, right? So we got the brakes going. We got all brand new tires on the car, right? We put some money into making sure that our son was going to be as well protected as we could make him before he goes out there and he's driving around by himself. So we got brand new tires on the car. He goes out there, and 1 month after we get the tires put on the car, I get a phone call while I'm at work. Dad, there's a light on the dashboard. What's the light? Oh, it looks like this. All right, that's your low tire pressure light. Get out and look at your tires. Okay, he goes out. He's looking at, oh, there's one that looks like it's losing air. I can actually hear it losing air. I said, how far are you from the house? I just left. Get back to the house. I was like, does it have enough air in it? Yes. Get back to the house. Okay. Goes back to the house. I come home. We look at it. There's a big gash in the tire. I don't know. What? I don't know how it happened. Whatever. Maybe ran over something. Maybe it was a defect in the, I don't know. Take it to the thing. Hey, man. Oh, all right. Road hazard. Let's get you fixed up. Blah, 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 blah. Get the new tire, put it back on, all right? 2 weeks later, last Saturday, 2 weeks later, I get a call from my wife this time. Joseph has a flat. What? Yeah, it's the same tire as last time. Wait. Same exact tire? Yeah, same tire. I said, okay. So I call my son. I say, hey, bud, what's going on? Oh, I got a flat. I had, you know, I was trying to pull into a thing, and somebody was pulling out, so I had to move over, but I hit the curb when I was pulling up, and the tire goes flat. I was like, oh. So I load everything up and a bunch of stuff in the truck, go over, change out the thing. We're looking at it. Have to go back to the thing because it's got a hole in the sidewall. Got to get a whole another tire. Thankfully, road hazard, you know, it wasn't too much. They just charge you to remount it, whatever. Take it back, put it on the car. We're off and running again. So funny thing about it is, right? First time, he calls Dad. It's a mistake. It happens, right? Second time, 2 weeks later, same tire, he calls Mom. And he says, Mom, I need you to break something to Dad. It's one of those things where sometimes we can forget. It doesn't matter how many times the tire pops. Dad loves him. He's going to come out there. He's going to help him get the car running again and get him back on the road. You care about your kids. That doesn't mean you don't get frustrated from time to time, like, oh, I can't believe you did this again. But let's get you fixed up. Let's get you back on the road. Let's get you pointed in the right direction again. God cares about us so much more than we care about our kids. And I love my sons to death. There is not anything I wouldn't do for my kids. And God loves us so much more. He'll pick you up. He'll help get you dusted off. And he'll help get you moving in the right direction again. There are probably some of you here today who would say, Pastor Joe, on the road of life, I've blown a tire. I've blown it again. I feel ashamed. And I just feel like giving up. Don't give up. Don't grow weary. Don't do it. Turn to your Father. Your heavenly Father, say, Dad, I've blown it again. Could you help me out? He will get you set up. He will get you back moving in the right direction again. He wants to do that. He wants you to be able to move forward. As I prepare to close today, I believe that the Lord wants you to know that he is still with you, and he always will be. Don't give up. Don't grow weary. Don't lose hope. God is stronger than your struggles, and he will set you free. It will happen. Don't know when. I can't promise you a day. But it will happen. He will set you free from your struggle. Don't give in to it. Let the Lord move in you. Keep moving forward. Won't you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for you this morning, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, that you love us, that you've paid the price for us. Thank you for being a part of our lives. God, for every person who's here this morning, for every person who's walked into this place saying, man, I'm going to have to put on a good face this morning. But in their mind and in their heart, they felt separation from you, Lord. They felt disconnected from you. They felt like there was something standing between you. I pray for each person who came in here struggling this morning, Lord, that they would leave knowing that you are leaving with them. That you're going to be with them regardless. That you want to get them moving in the right direction. That you want to help them. And I pray that you would help them to open their hearts to you this morning. And receive the forgiveness and the grace that you have for each one of us today. Be with them, Lord. Help them to have strength for their struggle. That whatever they're going through, Lord, that you would touch it in an incredible way right now. That you would help them to overcome those temptations, the desires that war against them. That you would help them to walk in step with your Holy Spirit. Father, I pray that you would set people free from addictions today. Free from pain today. Help people to be put back right this morning, Lord. I pray that you'd be with them and do the miraculous in their lives right at this time. But Father, for those who are going to walk out the door and walk right into something stupid, I pray that you would go with them just as much. Help them to feel your presence when they've blown it, Lord. And help them to not hide from you, Lord, but turn toward you and say, God, help me. Pick them up, Lord. Let your spirit rush in that moment. Help them to know that you can steady the ship and set them free. And Lord, I can't wait for the day. I pray that nobody here would grow weary in doing good. Until that day where you make us all perfect. Set your people free. Bring us home one day in your time, Lord, when you think it's right. And until then, I pray that you'd be with us. Help us to have the strength to do what's right. Help us to not grow weary, Lord, but to turn toward you and gain strength from you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want to thank you guys for being here. We're going to close with our benediction in just a moment, but I just want to thank everybody for being here this morning. It is a holiday weekend. There's a million places everybody could be, but you came to the Lord's house. And I think you were here because you needed to hear a message from the Lord this morning. If you're struggling, turn to him. Don't go your own way. Don't grow weary. Don't grow weary. Now go and enjoy the rest of your weekend. Let's close with our benediction. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask and more than we can imagine, to him be glory forever and ever. And God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you. Go in the grace and the peace of the Lord.